Thank you, Madhu, Shubhangi and Amir for inviting me. So I want to talk about learning arithmetic formulas.
Neeraj, can we hear your mic? Maybe
yeah. So I want to talk about learning arithmetic formulas, and I want to elaborate on this theme that lower bounds often help us in designing algorithms for learning formulas. So let me tell you about the setup. We have a field F and our favorite object, the ring of polynomials in n variables over F. We denote it by this, and we consider formulas, arithmetic formulas, and we'll always have alternating layers of addition and multiplication gates. We can assume that without loss of generality if we allow arbitrary fanon, because we can collapse adjacent gates which have the same kind of operation. So now suppose C is a class of arithmetic formulas. The learning problem for C, or the also called the reconstruction problem for C, so let me just call it C reconstruction. The following natural problem: given x's, given the polynomial fx, which is the output of some formula phi in C, we want to reconstruct phi. Efficiently reconstruct phi. Or more generally, given a polynomial f, we want to find the smallest formula in that formula class which computes f. So a good example to keep in mind is this class of formulas, which we'll come back to many times. Some power sum formulas. So they compute polynomials in the following way. The output is a addition gate followed by a bunch of exponentiation gates followed by addition gates, and the inputs feed in here. So the polynomial computed by such a formula looks like this.
So this will be homogeneous.
So how is the polynomial given, by the way, that f of x?
Yes, I will come to that in a moment. Given as a black box. So we can...
So you have to evaluate it on several inputs, and there you are going to say how many inputs you need to evaluate on.
Yes, yes. But I will come back to this in a moment. And these LIs have degree 1. So they are affine forms. And given F, I want to find the smallest number of summands required to write F in this form. And we have already seen these many times in this workshop, this formula class. And in general, this and in some sense, this class of formulas is the simplest non-trivial class, and we understand it very well in many ways. Now, you can, when you ask for reconstruction, in general, the problem becomes NP hard. So, for example, there's a theorem by Shitov, which builds on earlier work by Hastad, that finding the smallest formula in this class is NP-hard.
Oh, smallest?
Yes. In the worst case, finding the smallest one is NP-hard.
Again, but in the reconstruction problem, you didn't ask for the smallest one?
Yeah, so the version where we ask for the smallest one is NP-hard, and it doesn't matter much. Yeah,
even input is presented as a general arithmetic circuit, how will
this work? Oh, yes, so I should mention this. In this particular case, it turns out that there's an algorithm which, given such an F, it will output an ROABP of slightly larger size, which computes F, but finding a formula in the same class which computes F, the smallest one in the same class, is NP-hard.
And the same thing also holds for ROABP, right?
This ROABP we can do. So there's a...
smallest one?
The smallest one. There's a old result by Nissan from the 90s that Nissan and then built upon by Clevance and Spilka, that you can essentially find the smallest ROABP for any given polynomial.
Given, and that polynomial is given as what?
As a black box, let's say.
And how many queries?
Polynomial. Yeah. Yeah. So, in fact, in this result, the D is very small, constant, maybe 3 or 4. So you could write down the polynomial F explicitly as a list of coefficients. And so even when the polynomial is given as a list of coefficients, this problem is NP-hard. And here we will typically ask for the stronger thing where we can't even write down the polynomial completely, given black box access to F, we want to reconstruct the smallest formula for it. So in general, there seems to be no hope of getting worst case algorithms for this.
If you sort of relax this and say that somebody provides a sigma power sigma circuit, that you're not, let's say, expected to find the smallest, but you just want a polynomially larger size or something, do we know if this is hard or something?
We don't know. So it's related to this question of whether you can approximate tensor rank or not. So for tensor rank, we know up to certain factors approximation is hard. This is essentially symmetric tensor rank. Here we don't know up to what factors it is. It's, I think, quite plausible that you take the tensors which occur there and symmetrize them, and you should get a similar hardness of approximation here. So in throughout this talk, what we'll do is we'll by the way, for general formulas, we don't know whether the problem is hard. It's this weird phenomena which happens in learning, that when you go from a less expressive class to a more expressive class, we expect the learning problem to become more difficult or harder, but proving that it is hard becomes even harder. So, and in Boolean complexity, people get around this by saying that, well, for the more expressive classes, if it can, for example, if that class can implement the decryption algorithm of a crypto system, then learning that class will imply breaking the crypto system, and therefore you cannot learn classes. We would like to give such kind of evidence in the arithmetic world also, but unfortunately, it turns out that all the crypto systems where the decryption was very algebraic in nature, they have all been broken. So it's difficult to say what's going on. But it's probably a hard problem. So what we'll do is we'll relax it. Instead of worst case algorithm, we'll look for, in some sense, average case algorithms. So we'll want algorithms which work provided the formula satisfies some non-degeneracy conditions, and those conditions should be satisfied with high probability if you pick the formula from the field constants in the formula from any reasonable distribution. And so I will give you an example of this. But before that, let me make one observation in the form of an informal proposition, that if you have a formula, and then you change the field constants randomly. You take a formula phi for the tree structure is important, and then you vary the constant from the field, then with high probability every addition gate computes an irreducible polynomial. And let me not make the precise formal statement here, but what this means is the following, that you want to reconstruct phi. This is the formula phi, and suppose you want to do it recursively. So you want to get the top gate, the next layer of addition gates, and the next layer of gates, and so on. The polynomials computed at each layer of gates, you want to go down this tree. And then if you, for example, pick a random formula, and if this gate at the top was a multiplication gate, the output is the polynomial f, then the factors, then the next layer is addition gates. If there are s addition gates, this polynomial will have s factors, s irreducible factors, and those factors will be the outputs of the next layer of gates. So multiplication gates, at least if you are considering random formulas, are very easy to handle. You just factor the output of a multiplication gate, the factors are the children. So essentially, morally, the reconstruction problem is this. You want to get the children of the addition gates.
You want to switch pens?
So, suppose I have f, which I can write as a sum of s polynomials. And these summands, the GIs, are simple. They are simple in the sense that they are computed by smaller formulas of smaller depth. So the problem is, given f, find the GIs.
So why is the factoring easy if a black box model?
Oh, so there's a, yeah, there's a result by Kaltofen and Trager from the 80s that given any polynomial as a black box, you can output black boxes for the factors of f.
So find the GI, mean build a new black box for G1?
Yes, for each of the GIs. Yeah. So
what is simple, you said again?
Essentially, like for example, in this case, the simplicity is being power of a linear form. In general, they would be computed by lower depth formulas of small size. They are the children of the gate, so they are. So, So let me give an example of the kind of theorem that we will encounter today. So for this class of sum power sum circuits, we can recover the LIs in polynomial time, and this is actually a very low exponent polynomial. If S is something like at most n to the d over 3, S is not too large, and the following non-degeneracy condition is satisfied. Let's call this the that if you look at some reasonable powers of these LIs, they are linearly independent. So, and this reasonable being something like log s over log n. Don't worry too much about the exact e here. The point is this: if you take a bunch of linear polynomials, then if you raise them to sufficiently high powers, they will become linearly independent, provided no pair is a scalar multiple of the other. And what this is saying is that for some relatively small exponent, already they become linearly independent. And it turns out that this, so if you if you think of these S tuple of linear forms as points in the vector in a space of dimension S times n plus 1 dimensional space, then the set of tuples of these linear forms. So the every tuple of such linear forms corresponds to an input instance, and the bad instances, they form a variety inside this space. And this variety has co-dimension at least one. So it's a proper variety inside this space. So if you pick a random input instance, this will not be satisfied with high probability. This condition will be satisfied with high probability. And in fact, this co-dimension is much larger. So for example, in this case, it's one can prove also lower bounds on this co-dimension. But never mind. I mean,
what is the assumption on the field? Can it be a finite field or?
So this will work for all fields. The size should be at least a degree.
So I'm also puzzled, because if I have an oracle access to F, I have oracle access to F squared in a field of characteristic 2.
Right.
And it sounds like your condition S less than n to the d over 3, I can boost it by pretending that I'm trying to reconstruct rather than F to the power of F to the 2 to the k, right? And this way I can relax the condition on S being at most n to the d over 3.
What is said over there for the powers being linearly independent over characteristic larger than, let's say, S, that will be true. And in small characteristic, in this case, for example, these kind of situations will happen. But nevertheless, if this over any field, if this condition is satisfied, then the algorithm will work. And depending on the field, this condition will be satisfied with some probability. If the field is very large, it will be with very high probability.
And do you think of the condition that S should be smaller than n to the d over 3 as significant, or?
Just to give you a sense of this, actually, for some reasons, people actually care about this problem. It has been considered in machine learning, and the folks over there, they care about how large an S you can go to, and they can go to something like maybe 2D over 3 rather than, so D over 2 is relatively easier. You can go up to D over 2D over 3, but those algorithms, they work only over real numbers, and they also assume very specific things that the coefficients of these LIs, they are chosen from the Gaussian normal distribution. So for very specific distributions from the coefficients, you can go up to there. And yeah.
So in this case, you have done solved the reconstruction problem, right?
Yes. On average, on in some sense, on
so
average.
So it means that NP hardness really depends on those bad things in that variety you are talking about?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
This theorem is in the worst case? For worst case?
Yeah, if this condition is satisfied, then it's a worst case thing. It's like.
So you do it for n to the d over 3 because
yes.
I wanted to take a pitch. It's a d over 3.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
I'll
be
multiple formats.
So. So the message of this talk is that, by the way, this d over 3 is roughly corresponds to the kind of lower bounds on S that we can currently prove. And the entire message of this talk is that these the lower bounds that we have, they help us do the reconstruction. So let me talk a bit about lower bounds. And then I'll tell you why they could help us do reconstruction. So pretty much all the lower bounds that we have currently come in two flavors, geometric kind of flavor. So let me explain this with some examples. They use some properties of the variety of the polynomial that we are looking at, for which we want to prove a lower bound. So things like number of singularities in this variety, or the existence of large hyperplanes in this variety, large subspaces, large affine subspaces. And things are existence of points such that the curvature at A is zero in many directions. And it turns out that such geometric properties can also be used to do reconstruction. And if I have time, I'll give you some examples like that. But the main thing that I want to talk about today are the linear algebraic kind of lower bounds. And let me summarize them like this, that almost all the other stronger lower bounds that we have, they do the following. We construct a class of a space, a vector space of linear operators, which maps this vector space of polynomials to some other vector space V. Often V is also the same as Fx, but need not be in general, and sometimes is not. And then it turns out also that in most cases you can reduce your problem to saying that the F for which I want to prove the lower bounds cannot be written as a sum of a small number of GIs which are simple. So the construction of this set of operators has the property that L applied to GI has small rank. So by the way, I will abuse notation. So I'll think of this both as a matrix and as a collection of vectors. So you have a bunch of operators. When you hit this on a polynomial, you get a collection of vectors, and you can put those vectors in the matrix. I'll think of it both as a matrix and a collection of vectors. So if that happens for all I, all the GIs, which are the summands, then you get a lower bound on the number of summands, which is the rank of L of F by rank of L of GI, the maximum rank of a summand. So how do such such lower bound proofs help us do reconstruction? Before going to that, let me just mention one result where geometric properties of this kind help us. So, for example, you can show the you can do the following reconstruction. So, let me be slightly informal here. If you look at the classes of formulas where every addition gate has small finite. If every addition gate has finite, let's say at most M, then and phi is non-degenerate, and this is which is why this is informal. I don't specify this non-degeneracy exactly. Then, given F, we can reconstruct phi in polynomial in the size of phi N and D to the running time depends badly on the fanon, but polynomially on the other parameters. If I have time, I will come back to this. But the message here is that already these geometric properties help us do reconstruction when all addition gates have small finite, the S is small. And the, yeah.
Are these lower bounds natural? As in, are they algebraic natural properties or can be new?
What goes in here?
The lower bounds specifically for these arithmetic formulas, like are those proofs, can they be phrased as an algebraic natural properties?
Yes, yes. So this collection of linear operators correspond to a matrix. And the rank of the matrix is the natural property. So the main sort of thing that I want to talk about is when these finites are large. And here I want to sort of, we have some sort of meta algorithm to do this. So this is the situation. Given F, which is a sum of simple polynomials, I want to find these summands. So we'll see many instances of this today, and Chandan will also talk about one more instantiation of this. So, in the first step, we reduce this problem of finding the summands to decomposing a vector space. So, we construct some vector space U, which will be a direct sum of S vector spaces, and our problem of finding the summands will reduce to decomposing this vector space. And how would you decompose a vector space? You do the natural thing. You will construct a set of linear transformations, set S of linear transformations, say phi, each phi is a map from U to some other vector space V, such that S helps us decompose U.
So what do you mean by decompose? I mean, I can always write a vector space as a direct sum of two.
Yes. So these UIs will have the property that they will have a basis consisting of in fact, in all these applications, these vector spaces will be vector spaces of polynomials. So these UIs are also subspaces of polynomials, and they will have a basis consisting of simple polynomials.
Okay.
And we'll see an example right away.
So there will be some structural restrictions on what the UIs components are supposed to be.
Right. They should have a nice basis. So let's implement this for this class of some power sum polynomials. So now we have this situation. F is a sum of power of affine forms, and and we want to find the affine forms. So in this case, the U will simply be the span of some lower powers of these affine forms. So and each UI, so this is a space of polynomials, and each UI is simply the space of scalar multiples of the corresponding power of Li. So I'll in a moment show you how to do step one, how to give an F, and this number E will be something like D minus log S over log N. So very close to D. In a moment I'll show you how to reduce the problem to this, but suppose for the moment I have reduced it here, then how to implement the second step, let me show you. And this will generalize, generalize in a to almost all collections of linear maps. So
when you're thinking of Li to the E, you're expanding it, looking at the various coefficients you get, and you're looking at that, the F span of those polynomials.
Yes. So each li, it's a polynomial. I'm thinking of it as a vector. Li to the e is a polynomial.
Yes. So ui is really a one-dimensional vector in this?
Yes. Okay. Yes. It's a one-dimensional vector space.
And right now, the problem is that we have access to some basis for u.
Yes.
And we want to build a basis for each of the
u's. Yeah. So we have as input some basis for u. So let's say u is a span of p1, p2, ps. And I'm given these pi's. So I have some basis. And this is not a nice basis. The nice basis is the
light.
Yeah. So I want to find that. So I use the particular collection of linear maps which sort of witness the simplicity of powers of affine forms. So so in this case L is consists of all differential operators of a certain order k, and k is something like again log s by log n. So again, think of S as poly n, say n to the 100, then all these numbers here are k and this number here is our constant. So let's compute this matrix L applied to my PI. And let M be the space of matrices M1, M2, MS. So I have the PIs, I have these linear operators, I can compute these matrices. And the observation here, the geometric version of it, is that so think of this as an ambient space, and in this space of matrices, look at all matrices of less than the maximal rank. So let rho be the maximum rank of any matrix in my space. And suppose the following holds. Suppose this maximum rank is in fact the sum of the ranks of these MIs. Rank of any matrix in this space can at most be rho. Let's say it's exactly rho. Then the set of rho minus 1 rank matrices in M, they form a variety just because they are defined by equations. But it turns out this variety has a nice structure. It consists of S hyperplanes. And let me write down the more precise algebraic version of this observation, and then it will be clear. The algorithm itself will be clear.
It consists of S hyperplanes means these S hyperplanes, it is exactly the union of S hyperplanes.
It's exactly the union of S. So, so the same observation, but the algebraic version of it. You form this matrix M Z, which is in some sense the canonical matrix in this vector space. So you introduce formal variables Z1 through Zs and look at the formal linear combination of these matrices, and then take this matrix, look at all the minors of this matrix of size row by row. So this is just trying to capture all matrices which have rank less than row, and the observation is that the GCD of these minors will be a product of linear forms. So these Li hats have nothing to do with the other Li's, the summands in the formula. They are just encoding these hyperplanes. So the algorithm is now the natural one. We are given the PIs, we compute the MIs, we form this matrix, compute this GCD, factor it as a product of linear forms, and the coefficients of this linear forms will give us the change of basis required to go from this basis to the nice basis, which is this. And to see why this is true, again, it's easy to see. So suppose if the PIs were in fact the right basis. So the PIs were in fact the Li's. Let's just think about that situation. Then what are we doing? We have the matrix for L1 to the E.
Sorry, Neeraj, switch the pens again. keep rotating them. Okay, try.
So we are looking at matrices which are sums of low rank matrices, L1 to the E, and things like this. Intuitively, if you drop any summand from this sum, the rank will drop. And because of this condition, that's the only way the rank can drop. And that essentially is the proof. You can.
And the fact that each of these MIs is really, since it's a differential operator on Li, you're saying all those vectors are really the same. The rank of MI is actually 1. No?
Yeah, in this particular case, the rank of the MIs is 1. But so all these row I's are actually 1. But I stated, because this holds in generality like this, that as long as the ranks of these matrices add up, the space of matrices of will have this property. So just to summarize this, if we have this property after step 1, if each UI, each vector space UI here is a one dimensional vector space, and I have a collection of linear operators which can in some sense witness the simplicity of this basis of this UI, then I can use this algorithm to, given a basis of U, to find the UIs themselves. So this is some sort of one sort of generic connection between lower bounds and reconstruction.
Can you say in what way it witnesses the simplicity of UI in this case?
In the sense that that collection of linear operators, when you hit the basis element with the linear space of linear operators, you get a low rank matrix.
So this is roughly the Nissan-Nicholson partial derivatives method proof or something? This is
So for this case, we use the partial derivative. So in this particular case, L is partial derivative. So in a moment, I'll show you another application of this, where it will be some other collection of linear operators, not partial derivatives.
Sorry, can you just complete this thing? So how did we go from this observation to the construction of the set? Over here we're saying, suppose we have this condition, then we can somehow get the decomposition, and even that requires some factorization.
It requires us to compute this GCD. Uh-huh. And I didn't tell you this GCD can be computed efficiently, very efficiently.
And if you compute the GCD, are you still going to do some factorization to get the LI?
Yes. Yeah.
And the LI hats will somehow give us the LIs?
Yes, they will give us the LIs. So essentially, these LIs, LI hats, uh-huh. There is a S by S matrix which tells us how to go from this basis to this basis, to the nice basis. And the coefficients of these LI hats, they encode that matrix, the change of basis. It's an easy verification. You can just initially work with the case where the PIs are in fact the LIs, and then you'll see that in that case these guys will be just Z1 to the rho 1, Z2 to the rho 2, Zs to the rho s. And then when these PIs are linear combinations of the LI, powers of LI, instead of variables, we'll have linear forms.
And here, the assumption on this rho is satisfied because of the linear maps that we have, and not because of the condition on, like the non-degeneracy condition we put on it. So why is this thing? What is this whole rho equals?
So the intuitive justification for this is that if you pick your terms independently, then the matrices that you get, so the matrices that I'm talking about are the MIs, which are so if you look at this matrix for different I's, if the LIs are independent, in some sense these matrices are independent. And so what this is saying is that if you roughly, the independence of these matrices is captured in the rank adding up.
So this way you're using that assumption?
Yes.
And what about those P1, the U itself, how do you get in the beginning?
Yes, I'll complete that. So step one. How to implement that, and in this case it's very easy. You just take let me just recall. I'm given F, which is of this form. I take the observation which is there in the work of Nissan and Vigdesan, and other subsequent works also, is that if you take a derivative of a power of a linear form, you get, so if I take some derivative of L to the D, L is a linear form, then I get L to the D minus 1 times some scalar here, let's say some scalar alpha, and I can keep on repeating this. So if I take kth order derivative of a power of a linear form and look at the vector span of this set of polynomials, it will be the same as, it will be a one-dimensional space with basis L to the D minus K. So how to use this now? So if you look at the kth order derivatives of f and think of k as log s over log n, which I've said probably many times. Look at the derivatives of f. So, because of this, it's easy to see that every such derivative is a linear combination of d minus kth powers of the Li's. This is just because differentiation is a linear operator. And generically, what will happen is that two things will happen, that this containment will in fact be an equality, and this vector space will be a direct sum of these vector spaces. This generically, if you satisfy some non-degeneracy condition that I had mentioned, this will be an equality and this will be a direct sum. Yeah.
So, question there. So, what properties of MI did you use in the. So, was it in, what linear operators L would be reasonable for?
Oh, so this is quite general. The only thing that I use about the MIs is that they are independent in the sense that their ranks add up.
So this could have been some completely different thing.
Yeah, yeah, and we'll see in a moment another.
So here, this is where you use this log s over log n, this thing.
Yes, so for this value, this becomes an equality. Otherwise, in general, it will simply be a containment. So. Just to complete, given f, I compute the space of kth order derivatives of f, and this space, I choose any basis, and this will be my u.
And if you have black box access to f, you can compute the black boxes for the derivatives?
Yes. So let me go on to a slightly more interesting example. A similar example, but now I allow larger degree polynomials. So the degree of Li's, these are no longer linear forms, but some higher degree polynomials. Think of them as constant degree polynomials. Think of T as a constant. So it turns out that we again have for this reconstruction, step 2 works as it is, almost like here. Because we have a collection of linear operators which can such that if I hit that space of linear operators to a power of a low degree polynomial, the rank is small. In the first step becomes more interesting in this case. So in this case, if I look at the derivative, let's say the first order derivative of a power of a low degree polynomial, I get that polynomial to a smaller power. But now, by the chain rule, I also have something which is a low degree polynomial. Degree at most t minus 1. The u that we use for this is is essentially the same as before. What we would like to do is use a very similar u, some smaller power of the space spanned by some smaller powers of these LIs. But if I simply differentiate now, I don't get access to this u, but to another vector space w, if I look at an f like this and look at the kth order derivatives, the space spanned by them, this is some vector space w, but this vector space now looks like this. It is contained in the sum of S vector spaces, where Wi is the span of L to the D minus K times polynomials of degree roughly T times K. It's Wi is in general a subspace of this. So we define what is called this multi-GCD problem. Given this vector space W, I want to get back this vector space U. So more generally, suppose I have polynomials, a bunch of polynomials, and I let's say I have a bunch of S polynomials. In our application, these AIs are simply powers of low degree polynomials. And what we have, we want to compute this vector space U, but we are not given U, we are given W, which is some subspace sitting inside some the elements of U times low degree polynomials. And it turns out that assuming that a certain non-degeneracy condition holds, these in fact let me write down that statement. So for now let me just assume that this, the space that is given to us, is in fact all possible multiplications of U polynomials with low degree L polynomials. We have this entire vector space, assuming some, I will write it down in a moment, then given U, given W, we can compute U. And let me write down the condition. So define Vi to be you take each of these Ai polynomials, multiply them by polynomials of degree 2L. You get a vector space, call this vector space Vi, and suppose that the dimension of V1 of the dimension of the Vi's adds up, in the sense that this vector space has the thing as dimension what you would expect, or this is a trivial upper bound on this dimension, and in fact suppose if it is met, then given W, I can find back U. And essentially, that helps us solve this problem also. I will end here.
Thanks very much. Questions?
So actually, going back, so this form of fi to the s, so can you actually show some sort of uniqueness result for that, that you cannot have, like, if you have f1, fs equals f1 prime, etc.? Is it unique?
Yeah.
Is it necessarily unique? Because from what you show...
Yeah. So in fact, in all these things, the algorithms and the proofs tell you that if those conditions are satisfied, which our algorithm needs to work, then the answer will be unique,
yeah, right,
up to permutations and scalar multiples, up to roots of unity.
Right. So the question was, can you show the uniqueness in a more general case? That was the question.
In general, it's not unique. And that's one of the reasons of NP hardness, yeah, for example. But people have looked at it, and there are somewhat other sets of conditions milder than ours, which also ensure uniqueness.
So even if you can't say it's unique with high probability, if you choose this thing from some distributions?
Yes. In fact, that's a very good question. As far as I know, the following might be true. You, for general formulas, so you take any tree structure, the field constants in the formula you plug in randomly. And then I would conjecture that there's a unique formula of that size which computes the output with high probability.
It would be essentially follow from Terracini lemma, right? If you have a kind of, when you add up your varieties, you'll get something of right dimension, then you'll get uniqueness for random stuff.
For the sums of powers, maybe, but I don't see it for general formula. Maybe we can talk about
it. Any other questions? Okay, if not, let's thank Neeraj again. Back here at 11:30.